made, such as how long will the coronavirus be around? Do I have enough food? What will I do with all this time at home and no March Madness to watch? Will I be able to pay my bills? This is an appropriate time to think about Jesus and reflect on how Jesus is engaging us in the midst of opportunity and uncertainty. I really meant to say uncertainty, not opportunity. We can say with confidence, knowing Jesus, he is telling us that we can have peace, and that he is also telling us, as he told the disciples in John 14, 26 and 27, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and make you remember all that I have told you. Peace is what I leave with you. It is my own peace that I give you. I do not give it as the world gives. Do not be worried and upset. Do not be afraid. Knowing Jesus, he would also tell us not to worry, because worry will not change anything. Hear these words from Matthew 6, 25 and 27. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your lifespan? Knowing Jesus, he is coming to us in our need, as he did to the Samaritan woman in today's lesson. To understand that scripture better, we need to think a little bit about history. In the time after the death of King Solomon, the Holy Land was divided into two kingdoms. The northern part of the kingdom was called Israel, and its capital was Samaria, while the southern part was called Judah. There was a time when people had, foreign powers had moved into the area. Excuse me, one minute. That the Jews and the Romans sort of interconnected and shared many things, especially related to the gods or gods that they worshiped. And it became a kind of theological mess, you might say, for the people who were living in that area at the border between the two nations. And they called those people Samaritans. And Samaritans were really not popular with Jews, because they felt that the way that the Samaritans believed was not at all close to what the Jews believed and practiced and taught. So having said that, when Jesus approached a Samaritan woman, it would have been against his orthodox upbringing to approach a Samaritan. It was against orthodox teaching for Jewish males to talk to anyone who was not his mother, his sister, or wife. Here is Jesus violating two strict Jewish beliefs, practices. He was talking to a Samaritan and a woman. She was also surprised by this, because it was not unusual for Jews to spit on Samaritans. So when Jesus asked her to draw him a drink, she is, wait a minute, what are you, a Jew, doing talking to me,
was water that flowed from one place to another, and it was believed to carry with it life. So when he said that, he was perhaps surprised that her response was, "Where do you get this living water? Do you think you're greater than our ancestor Jacob?" You know, Jacob's well is still there today, and if you go on a tourist route, you may well be taken to Jacob's well. They will sell you little bottles of Jacob's well water. So she is concerned that this Jesus thinks he can give her a water that's better than the water in the well. Jesus tries to help her to understand. I'm not talking about this kind of water. I'm talking about the water that will keep you from thirsting, the kind of water that will nourish your soul and lead you to life eternal. So there is that first misunderstanding. You might notice that it's not just the Samaritan woman who doesn't understand what Jesus is saying. In addition, the disciples don't understand it either. They question, "Don't you want to eat, Lord? Reach in the bag and grab some." And he said, "I already have the food that I need." They're looking around to see where he got food and where the crumbs from the food that he ate are. And he said, "The food that I am talking about," is to do the will of God who sent me and to complete his work. Do you not say 4 months more then comes the harvest? But I tell you to look around and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. Jesus is saying that because he has been able to share with this woman and bring to her an opportunity to have life, to have salvation, to know the depth of God's love for her. He's fed. It was a metaphor. But they didn't get it any more than the woman got his offering her living water. Oftentimes we don't understand scriptures. And I'll have people to say, "You know, I read it and I read it, but it just doesn't make any sense to me." Well, stop and think. Give yourself time to pray about it and say, "Lord, it just isn't making sense." God doesn't intend for us to be confused. Give God time as we continue reading through more and more scriptures to grow in our understanding of God. The marvelous thing about the Samaritan woman is that when Jesus confronted her with the reality that he knows more than she thinks he does, and says, "Go and call your husband." And he's going, she says to him, "I have no husband." His response is, "What you've said is true. You've had 5 husbands, and the one you are with now is not your husband." All of a sudden, she sees Jesus differently, not as a Jewish enemy, but as a man of God. And she decides it's time to go and talk to the very she's not keeping her eyes down and trying to avoid hearing them or speaking to them. She is addressing them with enthusiasm and excitement. So they go out, they meet Jesus, they hear from him, they ask him to stay longer with them. And a whole community is affected because this woman had moved from her embarrassment, her shame, to talking about this man who was making a difference in her life. Again, we find Jesus taking people's anxieties, their fears, their shame, and letting them instead have peace and have worry removed. You might recall in Romans chapter 5, it read, "Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God." We have peace when we are justified by Jesus and his act of sacrifice on our behalf. Friends, in Christ, we follow not just a literal human being, one who once walked the earth as flesh and blood. We follow Jesus, one who has come to rescue and redeem every one of us. So let's drink deeply from the living water that he offers us today. I'm going to go ahead and give you the benediction, and then we will sing our hymn. The benediction comes from Psalm 29, verse 11. "The Lord gives strength to his people and blesses them with peace." The Lord gives strength to his people and blesses them with peace. God, thank you for giving us your strength, your blessing of peace. And we pray that as we